So what is the best thing with life? Of course, living. And what is the really sad part about life? The sad part about life is that we die. So why do we die today? Well, we die of cancer. Even if you don't get cancer, probably you know some friend or relative that got cancer, so everybody is affected. We have to stop this. This is why I do cancer research. So we've been struggling with this question, what shall we use to treat cancer, for a long, long time, for several hundred years. We've been desperate, so we've tried everything. The things that stood the test of time was the Willem Röntgen's radiation beam, the mustard gas, the nucleoside analogs, the natural products. But it wasn't until a lot later we knew that they all share the same target. The target is the DNA, the code of life. So what all of these treatments do is that they damage DNA. So what we have here in front of us, what we have in front of us here is potentially a curative lesion. So in the 1950s, 8 out of 10 children died from cancer. Today, 8 out of children of cancer live and survive. This is fantastic. What an achievement. So if you want to cure cancer, this is the way. It stood the test of time. So what we scientists in my lab and other labs, what we've learned through the last years of research is that the cancer cells, they have a high level. They already have this lesion inside the cancer. So the cancers already have the curative lesions inside of them. We don't need chemotherapy. We don't need radiotherapy. The cancers already carry the putative curative lesion in them. But then you also, you know, how can the cancer survive if they have this damage already inside of them? Well, they do DNA repair. They repair these lesions so that they can survive. So how do we do then? Well, we stop the repair. So if we stop the repair, the cancer cells will go away, but not the normal cells, because the normal cells, they don't have the damage. So only the cancer cells will go away. So the key is, of course, to know what type of DNA damage is there in the cell. Of course, we have damage to the DNA, but the DNA is made out of building blocks, and the building blocks are damaged 1,000,000% more often than the damage in the DNA. Yet every scientist I know of, they all work on looking at the damage on the DNA. And I thought, well, the damage on the building blocks, if it's 1,000,000% more damage there, that could be important. Maybe we should at least have a look. So I looked at it and I found that there's only one enzyme taking care of this. It's called MTH1. So what the MTH1 is doing is making sure these building blocks, those damaged building blocks in cancer, are not incorporated into the cancer cells. So now, those cancers can live and grow and propagate. So the MTH1 seems to be very important. So how about cancer? So if we remove this enzyme, what happens? So we decided, we'll remove the enzyme. The cancers go away. This is fantastic. This is fantastic because to normal cells, this enzyme, MTH1, is like an appendix. Normal cells don't need it. So the normal cells will not be damaged. They can live without this enzyme, but the cancers can't. All cancers, they rely on this. So here, we have found, for the first time in history, in mankind, we found an enzyme required for the cancers to grow, but not required for normal cells. This is fantastic. It ticked all the boxes to be the perfect target for cancer therapy, except one box, and that was druggable. We need a drug for this. So the MTH1 is a nudex hydrolase. The nudex hydrolase is, nobody's heard of these enzymes before. Nobody studied this. It belongs to the undruggable genome. The pharmaceutical industry call it the undruggable genome because it's so difficult to make targets for it, or, you know, they haven't looked. So this is something they don't want to do with. So I knew then that nobody will help me to do this. We have to do it ourselves. So I decided to go for a hunt, to look for a medicinal chemist, those that can make the drugs, and see if I could find one. And I talked with people, and they all pointed me in one direction. This is the man you need to talk with. So I went to him and said, hey, do you want to come and work with me in my academic lab at the university and try to find a treatment for the undruggable target? And he said, no, why would I do that? You know, I have a perfect, nice job in industry. It's fine. Why should I go and work for you at the university on a crazy project? Well, you should come and work for me because it's new, it is crazy, and will make a difference. And then he thought for a while, hey, okay, I'll come and work for you. That's great. I have a drug developer. Now I need a lab. So I went and knocked on the Department of Organic Chemistry door and said, hey, we need a chemistry lab. I think you have a chemistry lab. Can we use it to make a drug? And they looked at me and said, okay. And fantastic. So I put him in the lab and he could start to make drugs. And then we went to the Department of Pharmacy, knocked on their door and said, we need your help to improve this and make a drug. And they said, okay, we'll help you. Okay, so with this and hiring a lot of different people with a lot of different expertise, fantastic team of individuals, we managed to make this. This is an inhibitor of MTH1. We talked with the crystallographers and they showed, okay, we can look at this. This is the protein and this is how it sits inside the protein on an atomic level. We know exactly how this works. Everybody has been very helpful and helped us in doing this. Fantastic. So now we have it. Here it is. Fantastic. But do we know it works for cancer? So then we went to Roger Olofsson here in Sahlgrenska in Gothenburg. And so he had a patient. He cared for the patient that had his relapsed cancer that was resistant to all treatments. There was no treatment that could work for this man. So we tried it on him. Or we tried it on his cancer, and it worked. Fantastic. So now, you know, how did it work? Well, so it go and bind to the protein, and then we get the incorporation of these building blocks. These damaged building blocks are incorporated into the DNA. This breaks the code of life. The code of life is broken, and this is bad for the cancer cells. It will signal and kill the cancer cells. Not the normal cells. The normal cells will be fine. It will kill the cancer cells. So this is great, of course. Now we have the solution. So what is the problem? Well, the problem is, I haven't done this. I have done this before. I found the Achilles heel for the inherited breast and ovarian cancers. So for breast and ovarian cancers, I found a treatment that would work for them. It was the appendix of the breast and ovarian cancers. So it wasn't required for normal cells, only required for those inherited breast and ovarian cancers. I'll tell you the story of Marie. Marie contacted me. She had her third relapse of ovarian cancer, and there were no treatment for her. She said, Thomas, you have to help me. And I sent her down to Lund, where there was a trial going on with Niklas Luhmann. So she went to the trial, and after 4 months, she came back to me and said, Thomas, it is fantastic. My marker value has dropped from very high to background levels. The doctors, they can't see any cancer anymore. The cancer is gone. This was fantastic. So at this time, the drug belonged to a drug company. So what did the drug company do? Well, they decided, we'll stop it. We stop this. Okay, so they said, we'll put it on the shelf. And what is the reason? Well, the patient group that Marie belonged to was too small for them to make sufficient profit for their shareholders to be enough rich. So they stopped it. Next patients are coming to me saying, it worked so well with Marie, can you help me? I had to tell them, no. You won't make profit for the shareholders of the big pharma company. You're not making money to the already rich, so you can't have the treatment. The company didn't even allow compassionate use. They rather have the pills on the shelf than giving it to patients. They rather see the patients die. I didn't start to become a cancer researcher to see our discoveries end up not be given to patients and having them die. We have to do something differently. So I decided, this time we'll do it differently. We do open innovation, crowdsourcing. We don't keep this as a secret. We show it to the world, we share it with the world, we send it to doctors and scientists across the world to help us come up how to use this. I started a public foundation. I remortgaged my house and donated the money to start a public foundation. This way, public foundation is owned by nobody. It is belonging to the public. So in this way, no one could get hold of this. No company, no big pharma could go saying, we buy this, and then we stop it and put it in the drawer where there's nowhere to be found. Nobody can buy this. Nobody can buy a public foundation. So now, we have to do it differently. We have to do it together. We won't get any help by the big pharmas. We have to do it ourselves. I think this is the way forward. We should make drugs, we should treat patients because we want to treat patients, not because we want some investors to get rich. So I think it is possible if we do it together, but we have to do it together, everyone. So I think I've reached out to scientists and doctors across the world. I reach out to you. You have done amazing things. You have been supporting cancer research for years and years, and this has been fantastic. So I ask you once more, let's do this. Take this to the next step. Let's beat those big pharmas. Let's do this together. Let's make this happen in the clinic, in the patients. So I ask you for one last time, you know, make an effort. Let's do this together. We can join. We can join together and make this happen. And for this, you know, I want to thank you. I want to thank every one of you that really make a difference for cancer research. You can walk up a climb a mountain. You can, you know, run a race. You do so many things for cancer research. And this is so important. We can really make a difference. So I reach out to you and I thank you. Thanks a lot for everything you're doing. Thanks.